Good morning, church. Good morning. Welcome Lori Greenland back to worship, and she says that there is a blue Maxima in the back parking lot that's just still running. Thank you. Thank you, Lori. Okay. All right. We'll see you when you get back. All right, let's take a couple minutes to look at some announcements happening. So can we go back to that opening slide, Jimmy, just as an instruction? This is still the season of Easter. It's still the season of Easter until next Sunday, and then the Sunday after that is Pentecost. And that's when we have just one day of Pentecost, and then we go into what's called ordinary time in the church calendar. So this is still the season of Easter. The season of Lent is 6 Sundays. The season of Easter is 7 Sundays, as it should be. And so just as a matter of instruction. Okay, so today there is a sheet up on the front pew. If you're going to Sight and Sound, if you've put your order in for that, there is a sheet up on the front pew so that you can see how much you owe, and sometime in the next couple of weeks put a check in for Ruthie. Also, we are going to go and have our pickup picnic down at Cowan's Gap today after the second service. The weather might not be so great, but we're going to still go for it and just hang out for as long as we want to. So anyone's welcome to come and join us. Next, this week, baccalaureate tomorrow night, and then Wednesday night, men's fellowship, women's Bible study, and then graduation down at the school on Friday night. Saturday, June the 4th, we're just kind of an outside work day to just do some work outside, do some trimming, just sort of get things looking beautiful outside as it should be. This is the Lord's house. And then on Sunday, June the 1st, just one service at 10 o'clock in the morning, no small groups. So just 2 weeks from today, only one service at 10 o'clock in the morning, hopefully outside. We're going to turn ourselves so that the sun is not all in your faces. We're going to turn a little bit, and that will be the first Sunday also of July, August, and September, just one service. If the weather's not great, we'll just come inside at 10 o'clock. Next, also on that first Sunday of June, we're going to have a reception afterwards with some cake and cupcakes to honor Gary and Lori's graduation from seminary. So plan to stick around. June 10th, outdoor movie night. Sunday, June 12th, you see the things that are happening there, which includes a healing service at 6 o'clock p.m. on June the 12th. We have postcards that you can use to invite people to that healing service. There's a stack of them up here in the front pew. Please feel free to come up and grab some so that you can invite people to come to that service. And also, June 15th is our deadline for those who want to apply for a Daniel Wolf student loan for those who are going on to education or training after high school. So if you want more information about that, see Jay Mahampson. Bible school, there's still some slots for people to help to serve that particular week, the end of June. And I think, a reminder about our local mission week in July 18th. That includes everybody who is willing to help in some way. And if you know somebody who could use some help at their house, the applications are on the front pew, okay? That is all of the announcements. So I know that's a lot to take in, but for right now, we're here together as a church family to worship God, and I'm so grateful. So I want to begin by reading Isaiah 55, starting at the beginning, verse 1. Come, all you who are thirsty, come to the waters. And you who have no money, come and buy and eat. Come, buy wine and milk without money and without cost. Why spend money on what is not bread and your labor on that that does not satisfy? Listen to me and eat what is good, and you will delight in the richest affair. Give ear and come to me. Listen that you may live. Let's worship together. Pray together. Lord, we know that you are here. Would you make your presence known as we come closer to you? May our ears truly be opened as our hearts are softened and ready for your strong and beautiful and life-changing presence and truth. All this we pray with open hands and open arms in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand and sing together. many of us have sinned this past week? Yeah, yeah. It's important to acknowledge that, that we are sinners through and through. Not only have we sinned this past week, we've already sinned this morning. All of us, sinners through and through. So let's come before the Lord, acknowledging our sinfulness. Thank you, Lord, that you are merciful. Thank you that you hear us when we pray, even when we don't even know exactly what to confess, but we just know we are sinners. Hear us, Lord, as we confess those things that we know we have done that have not been honoring to you in thought, word, and deed. Oh, thank you, Lord, that we can come. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. John 3:16 tells us, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him will not perish but have everlasting life." John 3:17 says that he did not come to condemn the world, but so that through him the world might be saved. That's the good news of the gospel. Know that you are forgiven, and may you be at peace. Amen? Amen. Amen. Let's sing together. Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Thank you. Turn to one another and share Christ's peace.
Thank you. you guys do fist bumps? High five?
Yeah.
High five?
Yeah.
All right, we've got all the littles coming up. I love it. And some big people, too. All right, hi. Yeah, Carl, you can stay. Okay, so who can tell me, maybe one of you older kids, what is this? A lighthouse. See, this is the Cape Hatteras Lighthouse on Cape Hatteras in the Outer Banks, North Carolina. Why do we need lighthouses? Anybody know what a lighthouse does? Kindling? It's a light. It's a light. Sarah?
It keeps ships from crashing.
It keeps ships and boats from crashing into the shore. And so where Cape Hatteras is, it's actually called the graveyard of the Atlantic. Yeah, the graveyard of the Atlantic, because hundreds of ships have crashed there on the rocks, along the shore, and on the sand. And so they need a lighthouse to light the way that says, hey, stop. There's land here. Don't keep coming this way or you're going to crash. You know, in the same way, we have a lighthouse in our life, and that lighthouse is Jesus. Jesus lived the perfect life, and he told us what to do, and he lived it so that he would say, hey, stop, you shouldn't be going this way. This way is not good for you. And so Jesus, he is our lighthouse to say, hey, those things, you shouldn't do that. They just lead to destruction. I also have a second picture. It's a little bit grainy, but what is that? Birds? Yeah. I'm going to say you say birds. Birds. So, while also I was at the beach, every once in a while I would just see a line of birds flying across the ocean in the air. And every time there was one in the front, and every time that bird in the front flapped its wings, it would just go down the line like they were doing the wave. The next bird would flap his wings, and the next bird would flap his wings, and the next bird would flap his wings. And so if Jesus is our lighthouse, you know, we're also supposed to be called, Jesus calls us the light of the world. And so we are supposed to reflect Jesus' light. So if Jesus is this first bird, we're supposed to follow him in what he does and says. And so Jesus is our lighthouse, and he's our example, that as Jesus goes along, we're supposed to follow behind him. And yeah, there might be somebody else in front of us, but they're also following Jesus to help us know which way to go. And that's why we have our church family, so that if we're following Jesus, we're following each other as we're following Jesus to help us say, hey, stop, you don't want to go that way. That's not a good way to go. Okay, let's pray. Heavenly Father, I just thank you for our lighthouse Jesus, who lived a perfect life, who showed us the way to you, for he is the way to the Father, Lord. Lord, we just thank you for him. Help us to follow him. Help us to encourage and help one another when, you know, we're not doing what we're supposed to do. Bring somebody into our life that says, hey, stop, that's not the way you're supposed to go. Jesus shows us the way, Lord. I just thank you for all of these children. We ask your blessing on each and every single one of them and their families. In your name we pray, amen. All right, you guys can go have a seat. Yes. Good job, Sarah.
We're going to stand and sing together.
Thank you.
Sunday, we started a series of sermons coming out of the couple traveling on the road from Jerusalem to Emmaus that we find in Luke 24. And the foundational biblical truth that is being proclaimed in this series is this, that God is always speaking. That God is always speaking. And we can hear God speaking anywhere, at any time. So let me begin with a very clear and beautiful example. Before the service last Sunday, Ellen Heckman was standing up here at the front of the sanctuary, and she told me that that day would have been her daughter Sabrina's 35th birthday. Sabrina died in a car accident in December of 2008, 13 and a half years ago. Now, unfortunately, many of you understand how hard these milestone days are for so many. But let me just back up a minute. So before last Sunday's service, I had asked Elder Jama Hampson if she would help to lead, if she would read the opening scripture and pray our opening prayer as we started. Now, Jama usually, as she is today, attends the 8:30 service. But because we had a deacon's meeting, and Jama attends the deacon's meeting as an elder, she came to Sunday school and then came to the second service. She had let me know that ahead of time. Instead of finding someone else to lead that part, I just decided that I would lead the scripture and the opening prayer myself. So I had planned, I had asked Jama to read part of Psalm 46, which is what I was going to read. But that morning, I just had the idea that I shouldn't read Psalm 46, that I should just read out Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make your paths straight. So I had a meeting with Ellen on Tuesday night, and she said, I know you have no idea what God did through you on Sunday morning, but Proverbs 3, 5, and 6 are the verses that I have clung to every single day since Sabrina was killed. And not only did you read those verses, but then you preached about how God speaks to us if we would just have ears to hear. She said, I just needed to be reminded that God sees me and God knows me and God understands what I need before I even know what it is that I need. I want to show you a picture of Sabrina. Doesn't she look like her mama? This picture was taken just a couple of days before she died. Now, Ellen took a picture of the picture that she has at her house, and you see the scripture that's leaning up against that picture. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he will make your path straight. I take no credit. I take no credit for that. God is always speaking. He's always speaking to us. And the key is that we have to have ears to hear, that we have to have ears that are listening for him. The key is truly wanting, needing, desperately to hear from God, which I don't know about you, but I need that every single day in this world. I mean, we have to face the fact that sometimes we don't want to hear from God. Because we're 100% sure that what God may say is not something that we want to hear. That he maybe wants to take us down a pathway that we know we don't really want to go. I mean, perhaps it is that you haven't bought into the truth that God has a certain way that he wants your life to go. That God has choices that he wants you to make, choices that will bring you a peace and a joy and a freedom beyond anything that we can ever imagine on our own. But maybe you have not bought into that, and so you don't really necessarily want to hear from God. And you know what? We are all where we are. God speaks to us wherever we are. In a congregation like this, there are people from A to Z on the road of faith. I'm glad you're here. And I pray that even today, you would take a couple more steps forward, closer to the one who loves you the most. Let's pray together. Lord of eternity, thank you that you are here right now with all of us together and with each of us individually. Thank you that your love never fails or falters. Thank you for your word that cuts through the fog of this world and makes our paths straight. Thank you for your Holy Spirit who causes our hearts to burn inside of us as you speak. Lord, would you please stir up inside of us a desire to want to know you, to want to hear from you, to want what you want for us more than the temporary sparkles that this world offers. Our hearts, our hands, our ears are open. Speak, O Lord, for your servants are listening. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So we're focusing on this story of this couple walking from Jerusalem to Emmaus on the very day in the week previous that led up to Jesus' crucifixion. They're seeking to understand. I mean, has it happened in your life that there are things that have happened in your life where you can't quite wrap your head around them? I mean, you're just like, what is this about? And Jesus has opened the way for us to talk to God. So we talk to God and we say, God, what are you doing? I can't understand what is happening right now. And these are the sort of questions that this couple are asking each other on their way to Emmaus. And then Jesus himself suddenly comes and begins walking with them. But God kept them from recognizing him. And he asked them, what are you talking about as you intently walk along? And they stop short. They were sad, and then one of this, Cleopas, replied, you must be the only person in Jerusalem who hasn't heard about all the things that have happened there the last couple of days. And Jesus asks, what things? Now, as I read these next couple of verses, just listen for the unspoken questions. The things that happened to Jesus, the man from Nazareth, they said. He was a prophet who did powerful miracles. He was a mighty teacher in the eyes of God and all the people. But our leading priests and other religious leaders handed him over to be condemned to death, and they crucified him. We had hoped he was the Messiah who had come to rescue Israel. So the unspoken question is what? Was he the one? They said this all happened 3 days ago. Then, this morning, some women from our group were at his tomb, and they came back with an amazing report. They said his body was missing, and they had seen angels who told them that Jesus is alive. Some of our men ran out to see, and sure enough, his body was gone, just as the women had said. What are the unspoken questions? Could it be that he really is alive? And if so, where is he? Now, I'm just going to finish this little reading from the message now. Jesus said, why can't you simply believe all that the prophets said? Don't you see that these things had to happen, that the Messiah had to suffer and only then enter into his glory? Then he started at the beginning with the books of Moses, went on through the prophets, pointing out everything in the scriptures that referred to him. So as I said last week, my secondary reference is Pete Gregg's book, How to Hear God, and he writes this. When it comes to hearing God, the Bible is the very language of his heart. Nothing he says in any other way or in any other context will ever override, undermine, or contradict what he has already said in the scriptures. I suppose this is why Jesus doesn't just show up on the road to Emmaus and say, hi, it's me. You might think that would suffice, unquote. But he doesn't. What he does instead is to lead them, these two people, in a walk through the Hebrew Scriptures, in a walk through the Old Testament that must have been absolutely eye-popping and absolutely life-changing to them. It was like an onion. He was just peeling back layer after layer after layer, showing them how it is that the Scriptures all point directly to him as the Savior of the world. You remember what they said after Jesus left them later? Weren't our hearts burning inside of us when he opened the scriptures to us? So what he did was he took the scriptures and it's like he put a black light on them. You know, things are there, but you put a black light and things just shine a little brighter. He put a black light on the scriptures and showed them these scriptures that they already knew and showed them things that they had not ever seen or understood before. And he's still doing that today. He is. He is still doing that for you and for me today. He's still speaking to us as we read his word, highlighting things in there that will help us answer the many questions that we have about this life, help us keep our feet on a level path, and helping us get to a place of peace with others and a peace with him and a peace within ourselves, showing us the direction that our lives should take. Jeremiah 33:3 says, "Call to me and I will answer you and tell you great and unsearchable things you do not know." I think some of us sometimes are just looking for an experience, maybe sometimes a dramatic experience with God where you get all goosebumpy and all tingly all over. And I'm not knocking these kind of experiences at all, but they can't be what we are seeking above seeking God himself. They can't be what we are seeking above seeking God himself. The couple in Luke 24, they're just walking along trying to figure out their lives. That's what they're doing. And then this guy joins them on their walk. And they didn't know it was Jesus. I think if they would have known it was Jesus right away, they wouldn't have been able to hear a word that he said because they would have been so in shock and so excited. And so they were kept from recognizing him. And then they just walked along while he continued to explain the scriptures to them. It wasn't a fireworks event, not yet, anyway. It was an opening of and a revelation from God's holy word. I think many of us live by the belief, if it feels true, believe it. If it feels true, believe it. And that's the world we live in, that it's all based on our feelings. If it feels good, do it, right? But if you're a Christian, meaning that you have confessed with your lips that Jesus is Lord, not only of the whole world, but Jesus is the Lord of your soul, the Lord of your life, and you believe in your heart that God had raised him from the dead, then that should mean that the words of the Bible have authority in your life. That the words of the Bible have authority in your life. It should mean that the Bible is the resource for truth for you in the world and in my life and in your life. Whether we feel it or not, whether we're feeling it or not, because this is the main way that God speaks to us, folks. And perhaps this is another reason why they were kept from recognizing Jesus on the road to Emmaus. Because he knows that an extraordinary experience with him, a personal encounter with him, falls short unless it is partnered by a biblical explanation, the written word and the word made flesh. Otherwise, what? We're just relying back on our feelings again. And our feelings are so fickle, right? So do you want to hear God speak to you? Do you want to hear God speak to you? Then what do you have to do? You got to open God's word. You have to open the Bible regularly. Just like animals need to be fed, Christians need a steady diet day after day after day from the Bible if you want to hear from God. It's really that simple, and I know that you know that this is true. But one of the truths is this, is that there's never been a moment like this when the Bible has been as accessible as it is and yet so little read. At the start of COVID-19, Bible sales soared in Western countries. And, you know, many of us had more time to read it because we were stuck at home. But research has shown that between January and June of 2020, engagement with the Bible actually declined among both men and women. Pastor George Gallup Jr. says this, it's the best-selling, least read book in America. It's always on the top of the bestseller list. They don't even put it there anymore because it's always at the top. It's the best-selling, least read book in America. Now, I'm not here to make you feel terrible about your Bible reading business. I'm not. It's a very long book. It's 1,200 pages, approximately. It's a very old book, and it is very hard to understand. I think we can all agree on that. The cultural context is so very different than our own, I know. It's not always easy to understand and make sense of its message and apply it to our own lives. But just because something is hard doesn't mean that we shouldn't keep at it, right? Just because something is hard doesn't mean we shouldn't keep at it. This morning at this service, we're going to recognize Christy Shoup for making it through, going through college, getting her Bachelor of Science degree at the same time that she is working full-time during a pandemic at Fulton County Medical Center. Christy, it was a little hard, wasn't it? But you kept at it. Lori, working full-time and yet going to seminary over these last number of years in the craziness of ministry, there were times I know that she's like, not another semester, I just can't do it. But you did. You kept at it. Aiden, Warren, how did you ever, for the very first time, decide you were going to try pole vaulting? I think, how does a person try that for the very first time? And now you are the District 5 champion, am I right? Record holding? I mean, that's amazing. That must have been a little hard. You must have fallen a couple of times, knocked that pole down, that crossbar down a few times, but you just kept at it. Good for you. Not to say that your junior and senior years in high school during a pandemic going virtual, blah, 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 right? I mean, we just kept at it because if it's worth it, even though it's hard, we have to keep at it. And this is the same for us with reading the scriptures. Thomas Merton wrote this, "By the reading of scripture, I'm so renewed that all nature seems renewed around me and with me. The whole world is charged with the glory of God, and I feel fire and music under my feet." I love that. Now, can you get there, too, with reading the Bible? Can you get there from thinking that reading the Bible is like a spoonful of oatmeal to getting to the point where you recognize that it is a sirloin steak, bite by bite by bite? Can you get there? Yes, you can. But you actually have to pick it up regularly so that your mind and your heart become accustomed to it, so that you get to the place where you are relying on it just like you are relying on air, and you're reading it, even the parts that you do not understand. There's a survey of 40,000 people between 8 and 80. They discovered that Bible reading has a profound effect on both our mental and spiritual growth, but only if it's done four times a week, okay? That's minimal, four times a week. Once or twice a week is a negligible benefit. Three times a week, maybe just a slight improvement. But among those who study the Bible at least four times a week, and we're talking about you maybe just reading a couple of verses, but at least getting it into your system during the day. If you're reading it at least four times a week, there is a dramatic rise, a sharp uplift in your mental and your spiritual well-being. In fact, these Bible readers are 30% less likely to feel lonely, 32% less prone to anger issues, 60% less likely to report feelings of spiritual stagnation, and 228% more likely to be active in sharing their faith. That's some interesting, important statistics. So how can we engage more regularly in God's Word? I have three very practical examples for you. Number one, I know I've heard many of you say, but I'm just not a reader. I'm just not a reader. Maybe you're not a good reader, or you have trouble comprehending. So there's so many options for you if you are an auditory learner. I mean, it doesn't mean if you're not a reader that you can't have a regular, steady diet of the Word of God. Remember, I mean, listening to the Bible is how most people first heard God's Word. There's so many apps that are out there that will help you listen to the Bible every day. Find one and listen. One that I've been listening to is Lectio 365. There is a voice that leads you, it's usually an English or Australian accent, it's pretty cool, leads you through approximately 10 minutes in the morning and 10 minutes in the evening. Stillness, prayer, scripture, reflection. It's a beautiful resource, but there are so many others that you can use for auditory learners, or maybe just to mix it up for the readers, right? Number two, don't be afraid to mark your Bible. I mean, if you don't want to mark the Bible that's very precious to you, a particular one, then just go buy another Bible that you decide is you're going to mark up. Underline things, highlight things, draw pictures, whatever it is to help you remember ways that God spoke to you as you were reading it. And number three, take what you're reading and make it real. Put it into practice, actively and intentionally. Here's an example, Luke 3:11. Anyone who has two shirts should share with the one who has none, and anyone who has food should do the same. So you read that, and instead of just thinking about, oh, you know, I have way too many clothes, and I have so many extra things in my pantry, then just go to your closet and get a bag and make it real and get some things and give some clothes to people who need clothes. Get some things out of your pantry, not just the stuff you don't want anymore, and give it to the food pantry. It makes your mind and your heart happy. It keeps the scriptures active and living when we are actually actively living and working out what it is that we are reading. God is always speaking, folks. He's always speaking. The question is, do you have ears to hear? Are we willing to take the time to do what we have to do to hear his voice above all the other voices that want so much to get a piece of us every single day? We just sang, "Speak, O Lord, as we come to you." Now, this implies something active. We're choosing. We're actively choosing to come to him and open the word to receive the food of his holy word, we sang. Are we allowing God's word to shape us and fashion us on to love, spur us on to love and good deeds? All right, so here's a story. Way back in late summer, last summer, John and I started paying on new carpet for our bedrooms and for our hallway back to the bedroom. For a variety of reasons, way too many I can go into. The carpet was not scheduled to be installed until this past Tuesday morning. We had a lot of work to get ready for this carpet. We had to take everything out of our bedrooms. We had to fix a subfloor in one of our bedrooms. We had to take up some tile in the hallway to get ready for it. And everything from these two rooms ended up in our dining room and our living room. Everything was piled up. Our house was a total wreck from last Saturday on. Now, let me tell you something maybe you don't know about me. I like order. I do not like chaos. I like things to be orderly. I like things to be peaceful and calm. I do not like chaos. So inside of my body, I was very, very anxious over these last number of days. I was very excited for this new carpet to come on Tuesday morning. So I went to see Tim Browning early Tuesday morning at the hospital so I could be back when the installer came. I'm on my way back from the hospital and my phone rings and it is the floor company saying that the installer has canceled, that he wasn't feeling well that day. Well, let me tell you, I wasn't feeling well either in that moment. I started out by telling the girl on the phone that she should come to my house and she should look at the mess that we have been living with since Tuesday morning. That we had just that morning dragged our mattress and box spring out to the living room and now we were going to have to drag it back to our bedroom so we could sleep there because now the installer wasn't going to come until Thursday morning. Now, I wasn't yelling, but I wasn't whispering either. And then, guess what happened? God's word got a hold of me. God was speaking clearly to me, reminding me that my comfort is not to be my all in all. My comfort is not to be my all in all. My comfort and my need for order cannot be my all in all. There was a human being on the other end of the phone who did not want to make that call and tell me that the installer had canceled. She didn't need to hear my woes. She surely had other people she had to call also. How would I want to be treated in a moment like this? Sounds sort of like the golden rule, right? I'm sorry, I said. I know this is not your fault. I'm just frustrated. We'll figure it out. I'm okay. We'll be ready when he comes on Thursday. When I pulled in the driveway, John was outside putting some more things outside. He took one look at me and he said, "What's wrong?" I said, "Well, the installer canceled." And we just looked at each other and we just laughed. I mean, what else can you do in a moment like that? Well, okay, well, we'll just go to work then. Listen, if I'm not in God's word and God's word is not in me, get it? If I am not in God's word and God's word is not in me, that phone call is gonna go a little bit differently, right? I'm gonna tell this woman on the phone that she needs to work it out and get my carpet down today no matter what. But God's word is in me and I am in God's word, and I want to put that into practice every single day because that makes me better, it makes the people around me better, and it gives God the glory every single day. God is always speaking. God is always speaking. I pray that each one of us will find a way to get in God's word every single day, at least how many times? 4 times a week. At least 4 times a week becomes like a sirloin steak every single day. You just can't live without it. As we take up our offering this morning, we're going to go back and we're going to sing again, "Speak, O Lord." And I want it to be truly a prayer that you're singing to the Lord, asking him to speak to you through his word. So those who are going to receive our offering, you can go ahead and get ready. I'm going to play through it one time while you get your offerings ready, and then we're going to sing together. Amen. One more piece of the story. So Thursday night, after we had drugged so many things back to our bedrooms, John and I were so tired, we went out for dinner. And while we were at dinner, the owner of the flooring company just happened to be at that same restaurant. And he came over to our table and said, "I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry that this happened to you guys." And we were like, "Well, it's okay. We're putting things back." And I said, I know that was a tough phone call for her to make on Tuesday morning. He said, "Oh, I know. I was sitting right beside her." Thank the Lord that the Lord got a hold of me and his word got a hold of me. And when it was time to pay our bill, he had paid our bill.
Good and gracious God, your word tells us to come to you, to bring our requests before you because you care for us. You tell us to ask and we will receive, and that even when we do not know the words to say, your Spirit is interceding on our behalf. In a world so wired and interconnected, our anxious hearts are pummeled by an endless barrage of troubling news. And so often our hearts feel heavy for what is going on around us and in us. There are so many who need your healing touch, physically, mentally, emotionally, and spiritually. But you, O Lord, are not disquieted by such. You are neither anxious or overwhelmed. You, through the Lord Jesus, carried the full weight of the suffering of a broken world when Jesus hung upon the cross. You are the God of compassion in healing. And so we come to you today to intercede, to lift up our brothers and sisters. Lord, we continue to lift up Tim Browning. Lord, we just pray for him that you would relieve pain, that you would just encourage him, that you would help the doctors around him, that you would be with Peggy. We pray for Elaine Hall and Bonnie Cornelius, for Dick Eccles, and for all of those in need of your healing power. We pray for all of those grieving losses today. We continue to pray for Mike Parks, and we pray for Gail and Mike as Mike approaches this next stage in his treatment. Lord, may they feel your presence with them and your peace with them every step of the way. And we pray this for all of those battling cancer and those who love and care for them. Guide them, strengthen them, and encourage them. Lord, we pray for our country. We pray for our nation, Lord. Show us the way. We pray continually for the people of Ukraine and for all of those who are experiencing war around the world, for all of those with basic needs not being met. Lord, would you meet them? Guide us all as we seek to follow you with our whole lives. And this morning, we give a portion of what we have back to you, and we dedicate it to you now. Use these offerings for the building of your kingdom. Not so that our names would become great, but so that others may see the greatness of your name, Lord. Lord, we love you and we praise you. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. We're going to take a couple of minutes now and recognize those who have graduated who are here with us this morning at 8:30. So Christy and Lori and Aiden, if you three could come forward, please, so we can recognize you. So I have a picture of Christy. She graduated last Sunday from Wilson College. So proud of you. You can come on up here and just tell us what degree you received and if there are any changes coming for you as a result of that.
So I received my Bachelor of Science in Nursing. Currently I'm working at Fulton County Medical Center. I got promoted before I graduated, but I'm the Director of Patient Safety. I oversee infection and prevention, employee health, women's health, and emergency management. Not sure where God will take me next or if I will stay in that position. We'll wait to come. I am working on a certification in infection prevention, which is less stressful than what I went through with my Bachelor of Science, but very excited to be over. Do want to take time to thank everybody. I don't want to name names. You guys are all so special to me. Thank you for the cards, gift cards. Thanks to the deacons for supporting me over the 3.5 years of school, too. I really appreciate it. I love my church family, and thanks for everything.
We're proud of you, very proud of you. You're next. Yeah, we have a picture of you and Nikki there last Saturday.
So last Saturday I graduated with a Master's of Christian Leadership from Gordon-Conwell Theological Seminary. I did most of that work online, and you know, past 2 years have been through a pandemic, so that was fun. but it was a really great experience that we could all learn stuff together during that time. So just keep praying for me as I discern what is my next flourishing step where God may want me to be. But I'm here.
You are. All right. So no more telling me you have to go read. We can find other things for you to do. Aiden, come on. We're proud of you. That's a good shirt. Yeah. So what's next for you?
Probably construction.
Yeah? With?
Jack Boggs.
Oh, okay. All right. He's a good guy.
Yep.
Yeah. What do you like about construction?
Everything.
Okay. Well, there you go. Dave Kaufman, what do you think? Everything? Would you say that? Yeah? He likes everything about it. It's a big variety, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. That's awesome. We're proud of you, man. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Yeah. You're welcome. After worship, I want to get a picture of the three of you. We have gifts for you from the church, but at the 11 o'clock service, we're going to recognize Luke Kaufman and Gabe Johnson and Claire Coons also. So congratulations to all of our graduates. Let's pray together. We have a unison prayer that we're going to pray for these students, graduates. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you for these graduating students. We pray that you will give them direction, courage, and faith as they enter the next phase of their lives. Give them clarity of mind to move forward into the plans and purposes that you have for them. May they seek, receive, and follow your wisdom first and foremost. Raise up Christian mentors for these graduates so they have someone who will listen to them and pray with them in times of joy, of sorrow, of transition, and of confusion. May they be bold to stand up for your truth wherever they are. May their paths be straight, smooth, and right. May they be willing and eager to do good, to care for others, to love and respect their country, to grow and serve. Amen. Let's stand and sing together our closing song, All in All.
Thank you.
Amen. There should be a clipboard that's circulating. It's got a card on it for Tim Browning. Is that somewhere? Yeah, okay. If you didn't sign that card, if you could make sure you sign it before you leave, and Peggy, make sure we get it to Peg so that she can take it to Tim. So yesterday was Tim's birthday, very hard day for him to be in the hospital. He's gonna go to a facility for some rehab before he comes home, and please just continue to be praying for him and also for Peggy. Now to him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you without blemish in the presence of his glory with rejoicing, to the only God our Savior through Jesus Christ the Lord, be all glory and honor and majesty and all authority before all time and now and forevermore. Thanks be to God. Amen. Amen.
Church. She goes to the daycare that's held in the church, and it's very religious.